because there are individuals that need what you have.
All right.
And if ever you lose who you are, your productivity will be suspect. Your effectiveness in the kingdom of God will be called into question. Your destiny becomes a distant dream, and your life seems to lose its meaning. This is why the enemy, when he attacks the person in the body of Christ, is why he hits us with such force,
right,
to get us to forget who we are.
My God.
The reason why the attack is so heavy, it is not because he's just trying to kill you. He's really trying to get you to forget who you are. Can I share with you that the enemy does not have to move all the way to the point where the Bible says he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He doesn't have to kill if he can get you to forget who you are. If you forget who you are, he doesn't have to worry about you. If you forget who you are, he doesn't have to be bothered with you. If you forget that you have power, how many times have we paced the floor with the Holy Ghost? How many times have we gone through and have worried and have stressed, and we have the greatest power that earth could ever know on the inside of us? How many times have we walked the hallways in the hospital and we've come to the understanding that if I'm going through something and my family members are going through something, and I'm worried about whether we're going to come out of this or not, and I'm worried about whether they're going to be healed or not, and I'm worried about whether God is going to lay his hands in this situation, and I'm worried and I'm stressed and I'm crying and I'm foaming at the mouth, but I'm going into fits and conniptions, and I forget the fact that I've got power on the inside. I remember not long ago, after we got married about 18 years or so ago, my wife and I just laid down to get in the bed. I was not sleepy, Pastor Anderson. I was trying to lay down, and I remember sitting or laying up in the bed looking at the ceiling, and all of a sudden this dark image began to come through the ceiling in the bedroom, and it looked like it didn't have any much of a form, and I couldn't say that it was a person. All I knew is that there was this big old blob coming out of the ceiling, and I'm rubbing my eyes trying to figure out, am I seeing what I'm seeing? And so the next thing I noticed is these two hands, seemingly hands, are then stretched from the ceiling all the way down to the bed, and then almost like it was choking me. Didn't have no air, couldn't talk, couldn't say anything, and I found myself trying to move, and I found myself paralyzed. And so I'm looking at this image, I'm looking at what's going on, trying to wake up my wife. She's not moving, and so because I couldn't talk and I couldn't move, the best thing I could do at the time was think the name of Jesus. I couldn't say it, but all I could do was think the name of Jesus. So what I was doing was thinking Jesus until it came out of my mouth. So I'm thinking Jesus, Jesus, until it comes out of my mouth. And when I can get out Jesus, the image leaves, and Shreya wakes up, and she said, well, what's wrong with you? I said, I saw a demon in this room. I saw a demon. Now, I'm going to be totally honest and transparent and tell you that it scared me, because I never had that kind of experience before. I felt like crying. I didn't cry, but I felt like crying. And then I remembered who I was. Because I begin to say, if God blessed us, it wasn't much, but if God blessed us with this, this little two-bedroom apartment, not long after we got married, I'm the understanding that if God has given me this place, he's given me this place so I have peace at night. counselors who are assigned to help individuals who are struggling with mental illness. And they found a process that they call a parallel process. A parallel process is when you are trying to help somebody, but then you start exhibiting the same behavior of the people that you are trying to help. And so if they're nervous, you find yourself nervous. And if they're jumpy, you find yourself jumpy. And they said this parallel process can actually sweep through the entire unit of counselors, where you have those who are gifted, called, and anointed to be able to help those who are in trouble. But then they begin to exhibit the same behavior. They're not in trouble, but they seem to have forgotten who they were. They are the counselors, but they find themselves going through everything that they're trying to help somebody else out of. You say, but Pastor, what are you saying? I'm saying the enemy's job is to get you and I to understand, or forget rather, who we are in God. So he allows you to go through tests, trials, and circumstances so you forget how to praise. You forget how to worship. You forget how to get on your knees. And you come to church and you forget that the same God that delivered you last week and the same God that delivered you last year is the same God that's going to deliver you out of your test. Would you do me a favor for the first time? Grab your neighbor by the hand, look them in the eye and say, neighbor, the same God that helped me last year is the same God that's going to help me this year. Yes. I'm not just going through what I'm going through because I'm just going to be beat up by the devil. No, I'm going through. See, in the enemy, I have to understand that God allows me to go through what I go through. The enemy's trying to kill me, but God's trying to build me up. And the way that God builds me up is he allows me. Somebody say allow. Say it again, allow. He allows me to go through things I don't want to go through. So he builds me up by allowing me to trust in his word. Stop telling folk, bring my strength. Stop telling folk, I just want you to bring my strength in the Lord. Pastor, why are you saying that? Because if I pray your strength, then there has to be something that's going to be sent in your direction so you can exercise the strength that we just prayed for. See, folk want the strength, but they don't want the test to exercise the strength either. I come to help somebody understand God is not building spiritual bodybuilders so that we can sit around and do absolutely nothing. But what I can tell you is this, that God is building us to a place that when we leave the four walls of church, we will be able to send the enemy on the run. Now, the scripture says, and I'm closing, the scripture says, there's this man that when Jesus comes to the coast of the Gadarenes, you know the Bible story, this man has a demonic problem. He has a demon, but not just a demon. The scripture says, when Jesus comes to him and asks him, who are you? He says, we are legion, for we are many. One of the main things I love about the text, though this man has legions of demons on the inside, when Jesus steps on the coast, this man that is full of demons comes to Jesus. And if you notice in the text, the scripture declares that he worshiped Jesus. This man that is full of demons actually worships Jesus. I'm going to say that again. He is full of demons, but he knows that I am in the presence of the Almighty, and I'm going to worship him. Oh God. The scripture says that he tells him, listen, I want you to come out of him. Hallelujah to God. Why? Because the Bible says that this man, when he had this demonic problem, the Bible says all in the middle of the night, he would live in the graveyard. He would be out there crying and wailing at the moon and cutting himself, the Bible says, with stones. The scripture declares that they tried to hold this man down, and they put chains on him and fetters on him. And the scripture declares that he plucked them off. In other words, when they tried to subdue him, the demonic power on the inside of him, God says, we're not going to be subdued. He plucks off the chains as if they're just paper mache. shake. He plucks off the chain and says, I will not be bound. The point I want to say is this. This man who has a problem did not start out like this. He had a natural upbringing. He was not born, the text does not declare, he was born with all these demons. He didn't start out like this. Look at somebody and tell them, I didn't start out like this. Where the same God is, where the same pastor is, but because of what we are going through, we have become somebody else. Last week we ran around the church. This week we're sitting quiet with our arms folded. Last week we were on the usher board. But this week, because of what I'm going through, I don't feel like praying. I don't feel like serving. Why wouldn't it be something if every pastor in the country didn't feel like preaching to you? You can I tell y'all, if we're not careful as pastors, we will become somebody else. We will allow tests and trials to come and grip us. And the unique thing about pastors is that we have our own problems, we have our own families, but we have to carry the problems of you, carry the problems of other folk. We will become somebody else. Some of us have dealt with family members so long that we have excused their dysfunction by saying, well, you know how they are. They're just like, no, they're not just like that. You were not born like that. You didn't wake up like that. Something happened to you and you became somebody else. This man was not born with legions. This man was not born cutting himself. But the attack of the enemy has gripped him so that he has become somebody else. He has become somebody that nobody can bind, nobody can put down. But can I tell you tonight that when the master sees him, the master does not want to leave him the same way that he is. The master says that you can get free tonight. The master says that you don't have to have these demons for the rest of your life. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, you don't have to leave home like that. You can leave out of here with your joy intact. You can leave out of here with your praise intact. You can leave out of here with your smile on your face. You can leave out of here smiling, showing your 32s or your 22s or whatever you have left for purchase. You got to recognize that I don't have to allow my tests to make me somebody else. This man became a cutter because of the test of the enemy. This man became a crier. He lived in the graveyard because his tests made him somebody else. But when the demons were exited out of this man and they were gone down into some swine on the other side, the Bible said that the swine, when they received the demons, they began to run.
church, and I text on the night, and I take my second clothes. Please understand that now that the demons are gone, now that the test is over, I was meditating this afternoon, Pastor, and I began to think in my mind, this man was cutting himself. This man had all kinds of demons on the inside, but when the demons left, there was no residue of what he had gone through. That's why when God heals you, he heals you completely. When God delivers you, he can deliver you completely. Shake your neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, when I come out of this, there will be no residue. The Bible says that when this man, he is now free of all his demons, the Bible declares he is now clothed and in his right mind. He's sitting there. Luke, when he writes about it, said that this same man who has all kinds of demons, the Bible said he wore no clothes at all. You got a crazy man full of all kinds of demons, and he walks around with no clothes at all. He's naked, y'all. But when the master gets finished with him, he regains his covering. Look at somebody and say, neighbor, when I was going through, I forgot who I was. Say, neighbor, excuse me, but I need to ask you to forgive me. I was not myself. That was a test I was in. Y'all not talking to nobody. But touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, excuse me. Excuse my attitude. It was somebody else. Excuse my yelling. Please forgive me. It was somebody else. And when this man is free of his demons, the Bible says he was cold. Somebody shout cold. He was cold sitting next to Jesus, but he was in his right mind. This is what I came to tell. Big Bible Tabernacle Center, why you and I go through our tests, and we go through our trials, and when the enemy is trying to oppress us, and now we have actions that are not like the child of God. When this man comes out of what the Lord has delivered out of, the Bible says he is clothed and in his right mind. What you saying, Pastor? I'm only saying this. While this demonic man was going through his test, cutting himself, living in the dread, or living in the grave, I came to tell somebody that they tell me walking out of the pulpit every Sunday and giving up and throwing in the towel. But today, God has allowed this woman of God through cancer, through pain, through suffering, to somebody and say, neighbor, y'all not talking. Touch them and say, neighbor, say, oh, neighbor. It's with the mind that I serve the Lord. If I don't have my mind, I can't serve. I can't serve in the kingdom if I don't have my mind. So the devil says, I'm going to take your mind. The devil says, I'm going to trouble your family. The devil says, I'm going to trouble your family. I'm going to trouble your marriage. I'm going to trouble your money. I'm going to trouble your job. I'm going to shake your church. But you've got to recognize through everything that I'm going through, the Lord is keeping. He's keeping my mind. And so what I came to tell somebody, there ought to be another praise in this house. Not because she's just here. She's not just here because my grandmother, she's still living, but she's not here. She's lost the ability to talk. She's lost. She forgot how to swallow. They're feeding her through a tube. When I was in Indiana just last week, they took her to the ER. She's got can't talk to nobody, can't walk. They do everything for my grandmother. She's still here, but she's not in her right mind. Can I tell y'all, if God doesn't keep your pastor, she can't help you. That's why you ought to praise God, that God for many years, through many dangers, torn and slain, he kept her mind. Through many troubles, he kept her mind. Through trouble in the family, he kept her mind. Trouble in her body, he kept her mind. When she was sick, she was faint.